Serious, people who have killed another person, accidentally or on purpose, what happened? 1995, was living with my druggy mother and sister who was 4 years older than me. My mom worked at a bar, and as a 7-year-old kid lived half my time in that bar. We did have a house that more of a shed on a lot that was converted into a house. Well, my mom got close with one of the patrons who also drank a lot and did drugs. Well, one day she broke up with him, I guess, and he kept coming over threatening her. A few days later she gets a call from him, not sure what was said, but she tries to hurry us into the back room, where we kept our clothes. She attempts to hide us all under the clothes, but I start freaking out, and try to leave the house. As I get to the front door, a trucker pulls in. I stop and hear him get out, screaming for my mother. He tries to get in the door at first and fails. I'm about 3 feet to the side of the front door. He shoots at the door. I freak and jump on the top of the couch that is right next to the door, while also grabbing my T-ball bat. He kicks and kicks at the door and it finally opens. He walks in, and I put him right in the forehead. He instantly goes out. I scream and my mom finally comes out with my sister, and we both leave then call the police at the bar. That same night I went to go live with my father permanently, as my mother had arrest warrants. I didn't know, until I was about 16, that he had ended up dying in the hospital between my concussion and alcohol poisoning. I don't feel bad about it though. In 76 I was 6 years old. My grandpa was my best friend and my hero. He always wore striped bib overhauls, so I had to have matching ones. I'd sit on his lap and we'd eat Cheetos and watch Zorro. We'd also play a silly game, pulling hair out of each other's arm. We were wrestling around one day, and I hit him in the nose with my head, and it started to bleed, so badly that he ended up in the hospital. He died 2 days later. I was always told that I remembered it wrong, and I had nothing to do with it. Last year I was at my uncle's, another man who I greatly admired. I knew he would tell me the truth, so I asked him. He pretty much said I remembered it correctly. Grandpa was taking blood thinners and the hospital never really got the bleeding stopped, and he basically choked to death. Before anyone says my uncle was in hell for telling me this, I'm grateful to finally know the truth. Watched my friend fall almost 1,000 feet to his death while rock climbing. No idea why he switched ropes when he was watching me secure them. He even asked me to yell when secure. Took almost 45 minutes to get down to his body. Haven't climbed since. I know I'm late to this, so there's no chance it gets seen, but I need to get this out there. I'm 22 now, this happened when I was 19, and I still think about it almost every day. From the time I was really young, 4 or 5 probably, my dad had kidney problems. He was on dialysis for a while, got a transplant that lasted for a good few years, and then back to dialysis. The last stint on dialysis lasted 10 years. He finally decided he was in too much agony to continue treatment. He came home with the plans to live his last few days in the comfort of his home surrounded with loved ones. Fast forward 2 weeks, which is a long time to survive without dialysis for those who aren't aware. Dad's health was going downhill fast. All the symptoms of the end stages of uremic poisoning. We knew the inevitable was going to happen, and probably very soon. He was gasping for air with every breath. To this day it's the hardest thing I've ever witnessed. Hospice had provided comfort drugs for the end stages, namely concentrated liquid morphine. I couldn't stand to see the strongest man I've ever known struggle anymore, so I loaded 2 syringes with morphine, and put them under his tongue. I know it was the poison in his body. I know it was the sickness. I know he was suffering, and I made the right decision. But I also have to live with the fact that I know the dose of morphine I administered was what ended it all for him. It's not easy knowing that you technically ended your father's life. A car ran a stop sign right in front of me one night when I was heading back from a friend's house. I drilled it going at about 50 miles per hour. Everything went dark, and when I came to I was facing the opposite way on the other side of the road I'd been traveling down. I kicked my door open. Got out, and it was the most powerful sense of the realization slash depersonalization I've ever felt. I was totally out of body just standing quietly in the middle of the street on a peaceful summer night. Glass everywhere. My Ford Explorer in front of me just king destroyed beyond belief. I start coming to my senses, and hear a car horn, I look around and realize it's coming from the car I hit, so I start sprinting as fast as I can toward it. I get up close and see that the driver's side is totally crushed, the window shattered. I look inside and there's an elderly man face down against the steering wheel, laying on the horn, blood all over the place. To this day I can't play GTA at all because of that particular feature. I start shaking him like crazy and yelling, "Are you okay? Are you okay?" There's no response. So I pull his body back toward the car seat away from the wheel. And it's an old woman, not a man. Completely dead, face smashed up. Someone's mother and grandmother just lifeless and maimed sitting right in front of me. Most terrible image. Just totally terrifying and numbing to see something like that. I stumble down the street and up toward the closest house and knock on the door. This woman answers in her pajamas and I can't even talk straight or anything. I'm just crying hysterically at this point and finally get out that there's been a bad wreck. By this time people are pulling over and pouring into the street. I remember the emergency responders having to use the jaws of life to get her body out of the car. And then my mom showing up and seeing my car and holding her hands on her head and yelling, "Oh my God," over and over, as though she couldn't even grasp what had happened at all. As far as aftermath, I think about it maybe once every 3 to 4 months now. I have a ton of repressed memories from childhood/youth and that's another one that is buried pretty deep. I don't feel a sense of guilt, as I was obeying the speed limit and did everything I could, but I still tear up now and then thinking about some kid losing his or her grandmother that way, or someone losing their mother like that, or an old man losing his wife and best friend in such a horrible manner that late in life. I just hope she immediately passed away on impact and didn't feel any pain, didn't suffer at all. I was seeing a guy for over a year. One of those amazing people, hilarious, works with kids, takes care of family. I loved him. He was diagnosed with a malignant brain tumor. He had about 2 years to live. Lots of headaches, seizures. He was really ashamed and fearful of being a burden. There was a surgery offered to him. It had a decent chance to give him an extra 5 to 7 years. He wasn't interested, and that broke my heart. We talked, I convinced him. He agreed to have it, and went in about a month later. He had a massive stroke during the surgery and died. He had a DNR that I didn't know about. They had to let him go. His mom vomited when she found out. I'll never be able to face his family. It's taken me years to talk about it, but I think about him every day. I'll never forgive myself for being that selfish. I was driving on a small treacherous mountain road and my brakes went out. My friend talked me through it, and I was able to stop my truck by easing into the mountainside at 55 miles per hour. The truck flipped and rolled and landed on the edge of a cliff. My friend's head was crushed during the roll. He tried to breathe, but his neck was broken. He died as I was trying to talk to him. At the time I was a single mother. A man broke into my house in the middle of the night. I shot him on my tile entry, hit him in the eye, died on contact. Bled out all over my floor. 2 years old, didn't even wake up. He had a full abduction kit in his trunk. Had 2 guns and a machete on him. DA declined to press charges, and the state cleared me of any wrongdoing. I refuse the TV circuit. Talking about it honestly, I would like it if my son did not learn about it until he was at least a teen. All I know, middle of the night and someone broke in Texas. He played a game he wasn't going to win. I'm a locomotive engineer, I drive trains. 13 times in my 19-year career, so far. Someone ended up in front of my train that didn't survive. Suicide, poor judgment or no sense of situational awareness combined with a vehicle that takes a mile or more to stop equals death about 50% of the time in my experience. The nightmares of various incidents awaken me regularly. Pretty sure that I suffer PTSD, but if I do something about it, I will lose my job, medically disqualified. I cannot let that happen at the moment, as financial ruin would result. Please, stay out of the path of my freight train. Edit, wow, lots of comments. The railroad does offer counselors and some help, but yes, a diagnosis of PTSD would end my career. Thanks for the suggestion of self-paying for a session. That I'm going to look into. Similar to the others here, I was the driver in a car crash. slid on some black ice on the freeway, spun a few times, before getting T-boned by an SUV going full speed. Friend in the passenger seat busted up his head in the windshield, my brother behind me fractured his skull, and my best friend in the passenger side backseat died. My friends, at the time, used humor to get through things. I have a dark sense of humor, but they consistently went too far, and I ended up leaving all my close friends. 4 years after I had to go to court, because of other cars that were affected by the crash and my friend's mom was trying to sue me for more money than the $100,000 my insurance already paid out. I used to scream out in my sleep. I dropped out of college shortly after and attempted suicide. Much better now, but 5 years later, and I still get anxiety when it snows. 14 years old. Spent the night at my best friend's house after our hometown 4th of July celebration. Woke up in the morning to find that her mother had left us to babysit her 8-month-old sister while she, the mom, ran errands. We are painting our nails on the floor of the kitchen, while the infant cruises around in her walker, and hear a crash. We forgot to put the gate up, and the baby fell down the stairs in her walker. 7. King. Stairs. She hit her head on the railing, and died in the hospital after 3 days in the ICU. About 4 years of PTSD, for me. But no one really knew I was there. My best friend was branded a baby killer. High school is tough. When I was 14, my friends and I wanted to go to the beach, so I suggested the one near my house. It was notorious for bad rips, but I just figured that we would spot them and stay away. It was about 6 p.m. when we got there, and the lifeguards had gone home. We were in knee-deep water when we felt the pull of a rip. Me and one other friend made it out, but the two that were less than a meter further out than me couldn't. For the first 5 minutes we thought that they would be fine, and that they could catch a wave in. After that we knew that there was a problem. We started looking for someone, and finally found their off-duty lifeguard 10 minutes after they were swept out. The lifeguard got aboard, and was able to save one of my friends. He couldn't find the other. Her body was found later that night. If I hadn't suggested that beach, if I had been quicker to find a lifeguard, if I had spotted the rip, my best friend would still be alive. Not sure if this counts, but when I was a truck driver, in training actually, I had the misfortune to be the tool someone else used to commit suicide. We were driving late at night on US 277 between Piedras Negras and El Rio. It's kind of the armpit of Texas. Flat, straight, boring, right near the border. I was at the wheel, my driver mentor was in his bunk, but awake chatting with me. I saw headlights ahead, a long way off. Didn't think anything of it. After a while, they got close, and it looked like they went to turn left, only there wasn't a road there. Then they straightened out, and drove right into us head on. I had just enough time to see that it was a Tacoma, and the driver was male. All I could do was let go of the steering wheel and hit the brakes. We were busted up pretty badly, but we cut that pickup in two. I had a broken wrist, my mentor had a bunch of broken ribs, and a bruised liver. We got out to see the damage, and when we walked to the rear I saw a work boot sitting on the double yellow line, with about 6 inches of leg sticking out. I still get an odd feeling in my stomach when I think about it. Obviously, I didn't plan to kill the guy, and there wasn't much I could do without foreknowledge. Semis aren't exactly nimble, but it still takes a bit to tell yourself you couldn't have done something else. He had a young wife and 2 little girls,